2015, an opening. At 7:15, we have a public hearing on a commercial solar zoning. And at 7:30, we have a public hearing continuing on Sunset City. So we're gonna take the 7:15 agenda right now. Pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 40A, Section 5, the Town Plan Board will hold a public hearing on Wednesday, May 6, 2015, 7:15 p.m. in the Dexter Hall on the second floor of the Chalk Public Library, 40 Main Street, Chalk, Mass., on a petition of a Chalkton Select Board to revise the Chalkton zoning bylaw to Section 27.1, Administrative Subdivision D3, parentheses, B parentheses, by adding said subdivision to the following sentence. Any landscaping plans or a proposed large-scale ground-mounted solar installation shall include details showing that such installation would be adequately shielded from any neighbor's residence, roads, and abutters' land use. The complete text of the proposed revision is available at the Chalk Planning Board and the Chalk Town Clerk's Office for public inspections during regular business hours. Any person interested or wishing to be heard on the zoning bylaw amendment proposal should appear at this time and place of designation. Now, can you elaborate on that?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll speak as loudly as possible without microphones. One quick question as we start. Is anybody here specifically for attending this hearing? Okay. In that case, we'll still continue and maybe someone will come in. If I can update the board and summarize for everybody who's here what this is about. If the board will recall, you received a memo about 2 months ago from the select board that one select board member, David Singer, had some concerns about different design items related to commercial solar. The board reviewed that and respectfully disagreed. You felt a couple of things. One, it was recommending at that time, would the board consider a zoning petition to change solar to special permit? And as the state DHCD office tells us, there are legality problems with that. There are a few communities who are doing it, but the state strongly advised them to drop that and please not continue to do it. He also was requesting a zoning change on various design items of setback and layout that the board already has generically in their site plan. In response to that, they still wanted to put forward one item, and they did, and I can read the petition. I know I've given it to board members before, but his fresh copies, three in this direction, and the rest in this direction. And Jen, feel free to keep any of it. Plenty of these. It's the article in the zoning bylaw revision proposed for town meeting would add one sentence to the landscaping paragraph for your general site plan review. The one sentence is, any landscaping plan for a proposed large-scale ground-mounted solar photovoltaic installation, which is the arrays we see that come in through site plan lately, shall include details showing that such installation would be adequately shielded from any neighboring residence, roadway, and abutting land uses. Just to show the board, specifically in the bylaw where that is, Jane Garney had made this copy of that page in the bylaw and highlighted in yellow that paragraph. So the idea that the selectmen proposed is to take the sentence I just read and see if town meeting would approve to add it to this paragraph that already requires landscaping, but this sentence would be specific. And again, procedurally for everybody, under state zoning law, any zoning revision proposal for a town meeting needs to go to a planning board hearing, which you're holding this evening, and the planning board is voting a recommendation. The planning board is not approving it, not disapproving it. The board is only holding a hearing, discussing it, closing the hearing, and voting the recommendation that the board will then go to the microphone. I did see, not to put anyone on the spot, but David, this is the zoning petition that you sponsored. Did you want to speak or ask any questions? Or?
I'll make a comment. I would have been here sooner, but there's nowhere to park outside.
All I did just now was summarize what it is.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
There are pictures here, I'll leave on the chair if anyone wants to see, of another solar farm in Charlton. The idea behind this is to protect basically the character of Charlton as well as people's residences, your homes. This is a bylaw that is already in place in many towns throughout the Commonwealth. It's not new. All I do is copy and paste from other towns' bylaws to enact something similar here. I've actually, as Alan knows, trimmed it down to the bare minimum. It's non-discriminatory, so it should be applied to anyone who wants to put a solar farm in town. And all it does is it puts in a requirement that if you're going to put the solar farm in, you have to shield it so that everyone driving by can't see it from the road, your backyard, your front yard. If anyone's driven down Route 20, you've seen that solar farm. Leave Route 20, go down Richardson's Corner Road, you can see it. Drive down Bay Path Road, you can see it. There are at least 7 homes, and that's the view from their front and backyards. So this takes, I think, in my opinion, takes the pressure off the planning board. No one can accuse them of being discriminatory. You're making me do this, you didn't make that. No, everyone has to do it. And it protects your homes, your values, your privacy. And again, it's just a copy and paste of exactly what other towns in Mass have done already.
Dave, I got a question to ask you.
Yeah.
Presently in the zoning bylaws for solar farms, the planning board does have a taking plan.
I couldn't hear.
Presently in the zoning bylaws, there's a copy of the plan.
Thanks.
There already is a landscaping plan that has to be submitted for approval. And you know, the board has asked multiple developers for screening for privacy. So I'm kind of thinking, is this like a redundance?
No, because this isn't a requirement. That's a requirement. Anything that's been done here that's asking them to provide landscaping plans and everything else, this doesn't require them to do anything. As you've seen from Bay Path Road, Richardson's Corner Road, and other roads, they're not required to do anything. This bylaw would require them to have to shield it. It's not anything onerous. There's a cost to do business. This is simply a cost to do business. You want to come into town, you want to put a solar farm in, you're going to make a lot of money off of this. We're simply asking that everyone who does it, you still submit your plan to the planning board, but it's no longer an option. Give us your plan, the planning board will decide arbitrarily, you do, you don't. Everyone has to shield it from the neighboring homes and neighborhoods.
I would like to make a couple comments here. We did have a public hearing for the Bay Path Road. I forget who the landowner was, but he requested at that time that a stockade fence be put up to screen him out. The planning board did make that requirement. We have had numerous landscaping projects being done, even on Cottonwood Hill Road. They're going to be putting arborvitaes. They're using the chain link fence with the weaving in it so that the neighbors don't see it. We just had a public hearing just recently on Snake Hill Road. The first proposal from the solar company was to clear cut from the road to the solar farm. The planning board took it upon themselves at that time to tell the person, we're not going to accept this. We need to see vegetation from the road to your site. It was reviewed approximately at some times on Snake Hill. There was approximately 150 feet to 180 feet of vegetation that's still going to be there to help screen the neighbors. So I think the planning board is addressing these issues. We had the guy that lives up the street there. Ray Underwood. That was a concern of his, and the board addressed it. And Ray and the neighbors are very happy with the screening that is going on. So we do show that.
And I appreciate that, but the fact is that still doesn't make it a requirement. And if it was a requirement, we wouldn't have a god-awful eyesore on Route 20, Bay Path Road, Richardson's Corner that passed this planning board. Now, people who are not abutters don't get notices, but anyone from that side of town that drives by it, they all drive by that eyesore every day. And it's a blight on traveling, as far as everyone I know that ever drives by that is concerned. So if you could say they're gonna put in something, it hasn't happened. And I think it was Dudley, a neighboring town, who's currently in a lawsuit right now over a solar farm. And I think that having this bylaw in place because it's non-discriminatory and it applies across the board to anybody, takes that off the table for the town of Charlton. You know, it's a bylaw, it's non-discriminatory, it's something in place across Massachusetts, already approved, and I also view it not as protection of the homes and residences, but as a protection of the planning board and the town from possible lawsuits as well.
Okay. I like that, Alan.
I fully understand your intent and what you're doing, and you've explained it very clearly that you're looking for a sentence that is very specific to solar.
Yes.
But I completely disagree that we don't have anything right now. If I could take a moment, the paragraph you're adding it to is within our site plan application section, telling applicants what they have to give us. Paragraph B, a landscaping plan at the same scale as the site plan that shows landscaping features, including the location and description of screening, fencing, and plantings, including the size and type of planting material. Landscaping plans for projects that include no more than 12,000 square feet of gross building area must be prepared by a registered engineer or landscape designer. Plans of more than 12,000 square feet of building area shall be prepared by a landscape architect. So for what that means is, and what you see with every project, whether it's commercial or anything that comes in under site plan, the board has complete authority and responsibility to require them to put in adequate landscaping, which the chairman mentioned some of them we do. So we're not missing something, but I understand that you want a sentence that specifically calls out solar, but we do not have no authority, we do not have any no responsibility. We have authority, responsibility, and the planning board does that on every single project. So I do agree that what you want to do is add something specific to solar, but we're not missing something.
If I may point out, I disagree. In fact, what you just read, again, there's not one mention in there that's a requirement. And
I read one paragraph, if you go back to the
if I may, this is the same board, yes or no, that approved the solar farm at Richardson's Corner Road, Bay Path. And if it is, that farm went in, you look at these pictures, that is the view of everyone in town who drives by and all those homes. And this.
I'm fully aware of it. This, I can answer you in a minute when you're done explaining it.
That's fine. This is the view of everyone in Charlton.
That's right.
Yeah. And that passed this board as allowable landscaping to protect the neighborhoods.
And I can explain what happens at that hearing. The board has complete authority to put in no landscaping, some or all, whether your sentence is added to it or not. In this particular case, the abutters all showed up and they didn't want anything more than that, and the planning board didn't see any reason to. Now, what people like or don't like for landscaping is in the eye of the beholder. In that particular case, all the families that showed up said, all we want is a little arborvitae up front. Now, if you feel that you and other people go by and say we wanted more than that, if you didn't come to the hearing, or if you weren't one of those abutters, that's how it goes. Each of these is designed case by case. Adding your sentence in or not adding it doesn't change the authority, and you are wrong that the board doesn't have authority. They didn't result with this because the board felt we can't do anything. They came up with this limited arborvitae because in that particular one, that's all people who live there needed. If they wanted more, we would have done more. Mr. Wolfingdon said, that small row of arborvitae is fine by me as long as I also have a fence along the edge of my property. The board required a 6-foot vinyl fence. So we don't have a deficiency, but I understand that you want to call out and get more specific on solar. It's factually incorrect that we don't have authority and that we're not enforcing it. We have the power and we do it case by case.
I didn't say you didn't have authority. In fact, I said you had authority. What I said was, and I've been quite clear, is that it's arbitrary. It's not universal. And what I've asked for is language that makes it universal. It's applied universally to every solar farm that comes to town. It is not done that way right now. It's quite clear. Right now, the board has the authority to require certain things or not require certain things. And that's shown by that solar farm. You only required this. This board only required that.
You're misinterpreting the bylaw. The current bylaw that I mentioned, again, that paragraph, it is mandatory that every project come with a landscaping plan. Adding your sentence doesn't change anything.
I disagree, and so do lawyers for other towns. No. This has gone before. And I'm just telling you.
I'm sorry,
I spoke
those
with them.
Lawyers don't understand, or they're not.
I'm not a lawyer. You're not a lawyer. They're lawyers. I go with what the lawyers say. But I will point out to you, I have to leave
like
to go to work.
I'd like to move the
You're
going to
make your decisions. That's fine. I have to even go back to work. I left to come here for this. I will point out that, with all due respect, I disagree, and you've proven my point. My language makes it a requirement. There is no They have to give you the plan for their landscaping, and it is required to be, those homes wouldn't see this, using my language.
I'm sorry, your language doesn't say that. It just says that a landscaping plan for a proposed solar shall include details adequately shielded. Adequately shielded is the board's determination case by case of whether it should be a lot of landscaping.
I'll tell you what, I'll leave that to the people of town meeting and you guys decide if that's adequate shielding. With all due respect, I don't know anyone in the world who would look at that and call that
adequate
shielding.
Everybody who showed up in that neighborhood that night, for them, that's what they wanted. That was adequate shielding for them and the board in that particular application.
And those few homes that are the abutters, everyone else who drives by it, who didn't know about it until they saw this, what the heck is this? I think they would disagree. In fact, they've already told me they all disagree.
I'll argue
that point at town meeting. Only I'll come back next time and I'll put back all of my original language to require that any solar farms have to get a special permit from the Board of Selectmen. I specifically trimmed back everything I asked for, okay, to what's in there. After Mr. Gordon's recommendation that this would be language and this is what you'd want to do, and that the planning board may support it, may not oppose it, and that was fine. So basically, I pulled out all the other things in there.
All right, I will put that in. Not to interrupt you, at this time we have one board member who would like to make a comment, and then after that we're going to be moving on.
Dave, you're aware there's another solar farm on Route 20?
Sorry?
You're aware there's another solar panel farm on Route 20?
No, I'm learning about a lot of them going in now, too.
Yeah, well,
including one on Turner Road.
Well, the example that you're using here on Bay Path Road, you got to acknowledge that it's topographically deficient because you're looking down on it, therefore you can see it.
Actually, no. From some of them, you're looking almost straight across that.
You use Route 20, right, as an example, when you drive by on Route 20?
Route 20 is one example, but so is Bay Path Road and Richardson's Corner.
I think Bay Path Road is pretty level, but definitely you look down upon on Richardson's Corner and Route 20. So
from Richardson's Corner closer to 20, yes.
Correct.
As you come down Richardson's Corner toward Bay Path, no, it's more level. And
a fence
would make it completely blocked from view.
Not from Route 20 and...
From Richardson's Corner, away from 20, closer to the Bay Path Road, it would make it blocked from view. You're wrong.
My point is the topographical difference of how you're looking down upon it. Of course you're going to see it. But take a look at the solar panel farm behind Kid Power Gymnastics, which came before this board before I was here about 3-4 years ago, right, Alan? Can you see it?
I don't know. I will go look at that one.
See?
But what I will tell you, you want to talk about topography, that's fine.
Yes, sir.
I live there. You need to go over there to Turner, Richardson's Corner and Bay Path, away from 20 on Richardson's Corner. You will see it is not looking down. It is fully visible. Also, the one you're putting in now, or someone's putting in now, down off of Turner Road.
Yeah.
If you actually go up Mackenzie Drive, okay, below those canopies of the trees, if you look through, you will actually also see that solar farm regardless of topography. You have to go up there.
Okay, I got it. All right. I'm going to let this go.
Yep.
We did have a public hearing for Turner Road, and
I came to one of them, but I work evenings.
Okay. Well, at that time, you could have sent the representative. All right. We're going to take this under advisement, and we'll go before.
In terms of scheduling, this is the only planning board meeting before town meeting, so after closing the hearing this evening, before you close your meeting tonight, the board would have to vote a recommendation to town meeting. So that's the schedule.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
What do you mean by large scale? You're talking about being very specific.
Yes,
that's a very vague term.
Well, I had put in specifics, and about all the feedback I received from current and former planning board members, a lot of those were all pulled out, and that was left upon those recommendations. I had actually given exact acreage dimensions and setbacks and everything else, and told, you know what, simply take it out, we may not oppose, we might support this, take all this stuff out. So I took it all out. If they want, I'll happily put it all back in.
I would agree with David technically on the side of it, he's correct that what he's referring to is, his original draft idea was looking at acreage, and instead, properly, if this was adopted, it should refer to large scale, because we have a definition in section 2 of the zoning bylaw that defines the large scale commercial according to the state laws of how commercial solar arrays are permitted in Massachusetts. So that is a correct reference, and he's referring to section 2 of the zoning bylaw.
So
all
right. Thank you for your time and hearing me out.
All right. At this time, I'm going to take a vote to close the public hearing. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
At this time, I'd like to take a vote to see if the board is going to recommend that this, let's see if any of the board on the recommendation is. The board wish to recommend this before the townspeople.
Now, if I can add some more information for everybody, promise for you to consider. Frankly, a couple of thoughts. One, I certainly don't have a problem with it. I really don't. I think the important point, though, is the point I'm trying to make in this discussion is you have authority right now, and it won't change it, but it does call out specifically reference to commercial solar, and it says shall be adequately shielded. You currently have that authority, but by adding this in, it maintains that authority if you wish to comply with David's concerns that you have something specific in it. But again, adequately shielded does not mean that someone can say, to me, that means you don't even see the stuff. It's like any other land use in Massachusetts. If you talk to Kirk Gardner, who's the head planner at the State Department of Housing and Community Development, who's the planning expert for solar, he'll tell you that under any site plan review, you cannot call out one particular land use and mandate that that applicant shield it so no one can see it. But you can shield it in the opinion of the board that it's proper and adequate and blends in. That's why you've done on some of them up to 400-hour buyout. On others, you choose. But it's case by case by you, the specifics of the design. Your current bylaw does allow that. Adding this in will just add a specific reference to commercial solar. Your authority and how you handle things will not change. You continue to have complete power to be very, very detailed in your landscaping design for solar, otherwise or not. It's your call whether you wish to be more specific and add the sentence in or not. But that is the result, the two results of either adding it in or not.
I'd like to make a motion that we acknowledge that the zoning bylaw that we have is sufficient enough.
Chair Martin.
All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
What the planning board will do is they'll go to the microphone at town meeting, present that, and then it can be discussed and vote at the planning board at the town meeting. Any change requires under state law a two-thirds vote of the town meeting. Jennifer provided her technical review of the traffic impact report submitted. Jennifer, in her comments and her summary, recommended to the board that the applicant revise the traffic impact study and provide it back to us, and that's what we're focusing on this evening. This session is about 45 minutes or so this evening, focusing strictly on the traffic revision item. Then we'll have future sessions as we continue on this particular public hearing. But what the board had requested me to do is summarize what I've just said, and then turn it over to Jennifer for explaining briefly her summary. Then the board asks some Q&A, and then people from the audience can either ask questions, speak pro and con, on what we're focusing on tonight, which is the revision of the traffic design. There's one particular lady I spoke to who lives in town. She is an abutter, and when the time comes, because she was unfortunately missed the first session and traffic is of concern, I just respectfully request that the board, when we get to citizens, give her the opportunity to be the first person to speak. And with that, I'd like to give Jennifer the chance to summarize.
Good evening. As you know, at the last meeting, I believe most of you were probably here for that, I summarized what the conclusions were and where I thought there were still deficiencies in the traffic report. The proponent's traffic engineer did provide me with some responses in written form at that time, but then has since submitted a much larger document with backup on, you know, the data I was looking for. I'm just going to very quickly go through some of those items, what those issues were, and let you know what the end result was. The first item that I had raised was a concern regarding when the traffic counts were taken. Some of the data was collected on the weekend before Christmas, and that did raise a concern for me. The proponent had taken some counts on Brookfield Road during the weekday PM peak hour in both March and obviously that week, that time before Christmas, and compared those two. Although that isn't a direct comparison of the Saturday, which was more what I was concerned with, the data for the weekday was almost exactly the same once it was seasonally adjusted to an average month condition. So I believe that the Saturday data probably is very close, although it didn't give me the Saturday comparison. I think that the Saturday data is probably a very similar ratio to what we found for the weekday PM versus at December versus the newer March counts. Another item that was raised was that the traffic impact assessment did not account for the Jennings Road Extension subdivision that is located right nearby. When the response, although it didn't specifically add in that traffic, it did discuss the fact that they did include a fairly aggressive growth rate for background traffic, and they also took a look at what that subdivision would generate and what the current traffic patterns are. And it is true that based on the traffic patterns currently on the road, most people are commuting kind of away from this proposed site in the morning and coming back. They would not pass this site, just following the existing commuting patterns. And I do have to agree with that. I did check that and make sure that that was correct. So although the subdivision would have an impact on traffic, it would not be significantly higher than what was included for background growth rate already. I had raised the issue of the safety concern along Brookfield Road, which was likely due to high speeds. The letter from the proponent did indicate they were very upfront about it from the beginning about the stopping site distance deficiency, and commented on that there would not be adequate stopping site distance available for the speeds that vehicles are currently traveling at 46 to 47 miles an hour. My fear, again, is that arbitrarily lowering that speed limit does not adequately encourage compliance. The industry standard is when you want to set a speed limit for a road, you actually look to see what people feel comfortable driving it at, because that is a good indicator for how people think that the road should be driven, regardless of what the posted speed limit says. The driver behavior will only be changed if there could be better enforcement or some engineering solutions. I just want to call the board's attention to lowering the speed limit doesn't change anything unless there is increased enforcement out there, and so that will still remain a concern. My other comment was regarding investigating any other access points to be considered. The response on this item was just that other locations were not available, basically, due in part to no access points out onto 49, and it, as far as I could tell, I wasn't certain and looked to the planning board who is more familiar with the town, if there are other access points or other potential places that the site could be provided access, just in light of that stop and site distance concern. If there is not another option, then that is acceptable, but if there was another option that would be more desirable, it should be investigated. If another driveway location is not possible, I indicated that the proponent should consider signage to alert drivers to the presence of this driveway, perhaps even just during big events, because if you are used to driving the road, if this is usually a lower generator, being as, you know, on a typical day, it's not going to generate a lot of traffic. On the day of an event, you might be a little surprised to have all of a sudden a lot of turns there. You might come up on someone very quickly waiting to turn left, et cetera. So perhaps even just in a temporary sense to put out event signage or just warn area residents that there is an event, or in a more permanent sense, you could put an intersection ahead sign or, you know, something to that effect, or a high volume driveway ahead. There's a number of ways that you could sign it if you wanted to put up a sign so that people would be aware that you had a lot of traffic coming and going from that location. I did request additional information on other facilities be reviewed because I was a little worried about where the trip generation came from. Although the traffic engineer did investigate a number and attempt to contact a number of other facilities and was unsuccessful, but he did provide the data that he used to develop his estimates in the first place, which was not provided in the first submittal. So with that additional information, I feel more confident about the trip generation that he is estimating once I saw the methodology that he used to get there based on the two facilities events in Connecticut. And the final item was some concern about, and during the public hearing was really raised as a concern about the intersection of Route 49 at Putnam Road. And that location, as I had said in my report, you know, a lot of the site traffic is expected to travel that way. And as we heard again in the public hearing, that was a concern of a number of the neighbors. And rightly so, as it played out. The traffic engineer did pull together all of the data regarding accidents, regarding traffic counts, projected traffic. The operation will, by the build condition, fall to a level service F, if I remember correctly. Yes, a level service F, with lengthy delays for those folks who are trying to turn onto Route 49. I'm sure I'm not surprising anyone by saying that, and it also does have a high crash experience. So this is certainly a concerned location. What I have suggested to the board in my comments is if the town is interested in pursuing a traffic light or wants to approach MassDOT about a traffic light at this location, you will need further documentation and kind of a full study, checking all the signal warrants and that type of thing. I don't believe, okay, in this case, a project of this size should be required to, even if a traffic signal is warranted, should be required to put a traffic signal into this location, but perhaps an appropriate mitigation condition could be preparation of that study. So at least then that the town and MassDOT has the backup they need to pursue funding to provide that traffic signal, whether it's now or whether it's down the road. And that could be something that is done in conjunction with other developments or, as I said, pursuing the funding through MassDOT. And I think that about brings you up to date as to my comments. I would just say that in general, though all of the comments hadn't been as specifically addressed, overall I did find the supplemental materials that accurately analyzed the impact of the proposed project. So they were upfront, you know, as I said, with Route 49 and the potential problems there. And I think they adequately analyzed everything, and at this point it's up to the board. And if you need any further advice from me, I'm happy to provide it.
At this time, I'd like to have Chief Prevey make a comment about, he wishes to make a comment before we start asking the board for him.
Thank you to the chairman and to the audience. Since I've been here last time, you've had other hearings, but I have received some letters and some emails in regards to activity that has been reporting to me as far as threats or potential damages to property or removal of signs, pro, con, and what have you. And I would just say to you, and I sent the letter off, an email, a response back today to one of the persons that emailed me, and I just said this, unequivocally, if, I don't care which side it is, if somebody comes forward, provides a statement, provides a photo, or other evidence that you've perpetrated a crime against the other, it's my duty and my officer's duty to uphold that. I am not going to bias one side or the other. And if you think throwing cheap shots or doing whatever is going to be tolerated, if somebody comes before me, I mean, when have you seen at a planning board meeting, okay, you have a hired police officer here, okay, that's how contentious this is. And the idea is, each side, okay, I don't care what the issue is, and we all know hotly debated topics across the United States, okay, each side has the right to be heard, and this is a free country, and everybody has the right to exercise free speech and assembly, and that's what we're doing here. And the idea, this is a process. There's going to be, at the end of all this, there's going to be some kind of decision. And whether it's for, against, or somewhere in the middle, okay, that's where it's going to begin and end. And if people, because they're upset, take action against a proponent or an opponent, and the idea that my office receives tangible information that we can go forward with, and the people want to stand there and testify in court, that's going to happen. So if you think you're smart, or somebody, if you have people that you know are on the periphery that are, you know, just saying, well, you know, this is going to really wake them up if I do this. They're not here tonight, but they're known associates, you know, that they're going to do these type of things. It's kind of like, you know, people like in down in Baltimore, you know, because of, you know, the issue down there, and then they go down and they burn down buildings or loot or whatever. What's that have to do with the issue? Let's stick with the issues. Let's go forward. We'll go through the process. Okay, in whatever forums, there'll be a decision, and somebody will render a final decision whether this project does come to fruition. And then we all go about our business. But the idea is, I'm not going to champion one side or the other, but I would just say to you, if somebody comes before me, or one of my officers, and there's credible information, we will act on it. And if you want to, if anybody wants to dance with the devil, then go ahead.
At this time, I'd like to ask any of the board members if they have any questions that they'd like to ask Jennifer or Sun City.
I'd like to speak to one item, if I may, and Pete, I had a bit of a conversation with the applicant's attorney to explain what this item is the other day, and that's Jennifer's comments toward the end of her presentation about a potential traffic signalization study at that intersection. And the board has done that before. The one that most quickly comes to mind is you did a site plan application a few years ago for a business enterprise park that Griffin Realty Trust owns at the intersection of Route 20 and 169. And to parallel what that's about is the same situation here, so people will understand that. There were concerns from the Mass Highway Department District 3 office and from the Planning Board's peer review. What's going on? Can you hear that?
Yeah.
It went dead. Is that working? I'll speak loudly then. There were concerns on that project from Jennifer, who reviewed that one a few years back, and the District 3 Office of Mass Highway, that potentially down the line, this project, that BEP project, starts to contribute, as others will, to eventually the need for a traffic signal. And wouldn't it make sense to require that applicant at the time to do an initial traffic signalization study? So what the Planning Board required in that case was a condition that prior to the issuance of a building permit for that BEP park, that the applicant's engineering consultant will do that study and share it with the Planning Board,
the consultants and the District 3 office of Mass Highway at the time. Now, the developer has not built that project yet, but when he triggers that, and he's indicated to us in the next year he'd like to get going, that condition will trigger in. So that's an example of what we're talking about, of that type of a study that would contribute to...
It's like the cables.
Sure.
I'll be careful. That would contribute to understanding what is the impact of the particular project and other projects in the future. And it's a baseline. It helps the state, it helps the town, it helps everybody understand what the situation is at the moment as discussion occurs in the future of whether or not it qualifies for a signal or not. So that's what she's referring to, and I just wanted to clarify for the board and any newcomers that it's not something new. We've dealt with that in other projects. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All right, at this time, any other board members have a question they'd like to ask? No. Could you state your name and...
I'm the author of the traffic study.
Excuse me, just for the sake of time, if we can keep our comments to roughly 3 minutes initially.
That's fine. I just would like to clarify something, that the fact that I have talked with Mass Highway District 3, the traffic engineer there, regarding Route 49, because it is level F existing, and...
They'd like to move the money.
Yeah, they're asking that.
Okay, I've spoken with Joseph Frawley, the traffic engineer in charge of District 3, and told him about the fact that we're running level service F without our project and with our project. And he's aware of the fact that there's this is a commuter route, basically people going cutting down to Route 20, the Charlton City area here. And what he stated was, unless there was a tremendous number of vehicles that would be proven to need a traffic signal, he said, I really don't want to see a traffic light on that road because it's a 55 mile an hour zone. Even though there's almost 800 feet of sight distance coming for southbound, if you've got traffic queued up at a traffic light, you're eating up that sight distance basically. And the roadway was designed as an interstate highway. They only built half of it. So that's why you have such long straightaways, you have nice vertical curves. So the point is, he doesn't really want cars coming over the hill southbound and having people lined up on Route 49 and having the sight distance reduced compared to having an intersection. So he's not really interested in that. And as far as the accident number goes, it's the average is 0.66 accidents per million vehicles driving through a non-signalized intersection in the state, the district, and we have 0.83. So it's not much above the limit of what is average. So what his point was, how about if we were to paint the word stop in front of the stop lines, which is what they're doing now at intersections that have a little bit higher in accidents, and also fund putting the reflective strips on the posts for the stop signs. So that would be for both sides of Putnam Road, painting the long word stop right in front of the stop lines and putting the reflectors on. So the proponent agrees to do that, and we're planning on doing that. As far as the actual driveway, just to quickly summarize, we are planning on putting up this type of a sign right here, basically, which is intersection ahead for both directions. We put it in 125 feet away from the intersection, what the MUTCD calls for. So we'll have that type of a sign on both ways to let people know that there is an intersection. And the proponent's planning on putting a sign up, certainly when there's an event. And they're also going to hire a police detail on the days of an event. So the 10 days or so a year that occurs, they'll have a police officer out there directing traffic right in front of the site. So the other days, there's just a few people coming and going practicing, which is a much lighter load of traffic. So that's all I really want to summarize is what we've done since we actually have the comments received.
Just a comment back, first of all, thank you for that information. And procedurally, what I'd recommend on this item is I requested the board if Attorney O'Neill in the near future, if you could prepare a correspondence to the board summarizing what Mr. Crystal just provided, that we can have for the board and anybody else who's interested to share as we continue the deliberation. I'd like to go back, though, to giving the board the opportunity to Q&A, and then the board can move to anybody else.
Okay, at this time, we're going to open up a public comment. We're going to try to limit everything. You're going to state your name, your address, and we're going to try to get the Charlton people in first for their comments. It is a thing in Charlton, so we'd like to have that. This time, I'd like to ask the lady if you would mind stating her name and address.
Change the board.
Aye.
Thank you, Chief. Good evening. Thank you. My name is Julie Darwin, and at first I wanted to thank you to the board and the town planner and everyone else for letting me speak and sharing my safety concerns with regards to the project. I reside on 15 Stafford Street and with my family. We've been in Charlton for 15 years and my children have attended Charlton schools pretty much their whole lives. I chose to raise them here because it's a great town with some great people. I would like to specifically address the traffic impact analysis peer review memo addendum by Conley Associates individually, and then my specific safety concerns as a whole, and I will be brief. The main question that I have for the town planner and the planning board and Conley Associates is, how is it possible that the most dangerous intersection in Charlton, located at Brookfield Road, which is also at that point Route 31, in the intersection of Stafford Street, it's been completely left out of the loop when it comes to planning the fate of Brookfield Road. I'd like to remind the planner and the board that there's no such thing as North Brookfield Road. It is Brookfield Road, which runs, as you know, from Route 49 in Sturbridge to Route 20, actually in Charlton. And if you go to leave the proposed project's driveway, your choice will be take a left or take a right. That's pretty much what it boils down to. And if you choose right, there's going to be, and there's no arguing that that will be an option, you will most likely end up directly at the most dangerous intersection in Charlton, which again is Brookfield Road and Stafford Street. Interestingly, I did a word search in the traffic impact analysis peer review memo addendum. The peer review memo, as well as the traffic impact analysis addendum, and I searched the word Stafford, which never comes up. In the initial report traffic impact analysis, Stafford Street comes up only in the 2010 Mass Department of Transportation report in the crash report section and is not generated by any other source. Using the Charlton Police data, which accidents by street name from January of 2010 through January of 2015, there wasn't a month that went by that there was not an accident on Brookfield Road. There wasn't a month that there was not an accident on Stafford Street. On Brookfield Road, the very loose data shows a total of 83 crashes in those 5 years, and a total of 27 crashes on Stafford Street. And I say loose because it would be interesting to study the actual facts of like how we're labeling the accidents that occur there very, very, very regularly. It seems imperative that the true data from the entire length of Brookfield Road should be studied and included for the safety of all. Even one more car on Brookfield Road is dangerous as it is today. If an existing problem is not recognized, then how can it be corrected? I am a witness to crashes occurring on a very frequent basis, occurring on Brookfield Road and Stafford Street. It's to the point my children hear a loud noise and just assume it's a crash. And the worst ones are actually when the motorcycles crash, because they don't make a noise. It's just a sickening thud, and that is the truth. And every day, we see people, and I personally have seen people from all directions breeze through without stopping, every single day. Chief Pervier has done a fine, wonderful job having the police sit at the corner, but it is very simplistic to say it's all on him and the police department with regards to the safety of this road, specifically this intersection. And, you know, there's a total of actually four intersections, but this is the main concern at this point in time. There are many things that can be done to address the existing and potential problems, such as the fact when you're specifically traveling from Brookfield Road to Route 20, drivers get tunnel vision and they focus solely on the Route 20 stoplight instead of at that intersection. And it happens from every direction. I've personally seen all types of vehicles involved, including trucks, vans, cars, motorcycles, you name it. That does not include the near misses that are every day. And we know, because not only am I on the porch watching them, I hear horns. Every single day you hear a near miss. So traffic at that intersection can be very high in the evenings when people are headed to their homes, away from work. And that is what I anticipate with increased traffic after certain events will be inherent, as that's the very nature of event planning. I worry that the fact the fire station and the emergency services, which are located on Power Station Road, and the impact on that fact has yet to even be included, discussed, or talked about. Increased traffic on all sides of the streets that Brookfield Road branches off in Charlton, you know, because I noticed the topic was a lot of concern with 49. I'm mainly concerned with this intersection. I was unable to previously be here, but it branches off into roads such as South Sturbridge Road, Power Station Road, and Stafford Street. And they have existing traffic that's not being included in all of the traffic reports. So I implore the planner, the board, and the powers that be include these critical safety statistics and concerns when discussing and improving increased traffic and the use of resources on Brookfield Road and the additional roads that will bear the burden. And finally, there is an existing issue about tractor-trailer trucks at Stafford and Brookfield Road. The width is not that big. It's very small. So not only does the width at the end affect the tractor trailers, but also the vehicles moving for emergency services, which is located at the very heart of Charlton City. So these are the issues that need to be included and at the very least discussed, in my opinion. And until then, these reports are, in fact, I consider to be incomplete. Thank you for your time.
Chairman, I just have two questions. The first one to help with my continuing education on this project. As we talk about the driveway at 215 Brookfield Road and have these hearings, is there any requirement that that land be part of the Sunset City LLC while we're having these hearings? Because in my last investigation, there was no land at all in the Sunset City LLC. The properties are all privately owned. And I was just wondering, as we go through this hearing, are we talking about land that is owned by the Sunset City LLC or privately owned?
Thank you for that question. In terms of any site plan, any subdivision plan, any special permit that comes before the planning board, there is no requirement of particulars of ownership. The plans identify in various pieces or parcels on every plan now or former ownership. So the answer is it doesn't have any impact one way or the other on determination of any projects, but it's a very fair and valid question.
My second question, Mr. Chairman, refers back to Ms. Connolly's comment about the line of sight for the new driveway and the thought process of that there's no other access point along Brookfield Road. Having lived there since 1984, I would say there are other spots along Brookfield Road that would make a greater access to it that would give greater line of sight. If you travel past the driveway in question, probably about 2 seconds in the car and look to your left, there's flat land that could clearly be an access to the potential project. So I'm just wondering, Mr. Chairman, is there a possibility of the planning board, and I know that proponents don't want to do it, but is there a possibility to ask the proponents to come back with alternative driveways off of Brookfield Road that would be greater in terms of safety and concerns of the community?
This time. He was just questioning the property location. And it's not working.
Go.
Guys,
right.
Let's get a microphone.
Let's change the microphones. I mean, it's like something different.
There's also the Mr. Jennings' mother's house is there, and there are some other issues. We feel that this is an appropriate location, and that's what we're proposing. And it's also, I guess, in terms of topography, it's at the crest of the hill. I'm not convinced that it's necessarily a better location than what's proposed.
We have one more.
Is it working?
A little stable.
Yes, it is. Thank you, Board, for... Oh, John Sanborn, 12 Jennings Road in Charlton. Thank you for tonight's forum. I just want to be sure that the traffic engineers took into account the to-be-built Jennings Road extension intersection, which abuts the Career property, and it will be approximately 175 feet. From the entrance. Was that taken into account?
I certainly was aware that it existed. They are far enough apart that you would analyze them. They're far enough apart that you would analyze them separately anyway. So, you know, I was aware of its existence, obviously, because it came into my comments. But if you don't analyze the intersection as one intersection unless it's offset by a much smaller distance than that.
So it's not a same issue.
Correct.
Okay. All right. That's that one. Another quick one. Anybody who drives Brookfield Road at night, next time you're doing it, I'm sure we all probably have done this, take a look at every single intersection and every single bend in the road, every single one, there's a street light. You want to make Putnam Road and Route 49 a little safer? Put some telephone pole power lines down there and put in a simple street light. I guarantee you, you will have fewer nighttime crashes. There's no poles there. That's why they don't have one now. Just a suggestion. That's all I have, guys.
Thank you. At this time, do we have another child resident who would like to make a comment?
Thank you. Good evening, and thanks for letting us speak. I just wanted to bring up one more point that it seems to me was missed by both of the traffic studies. If you look on page 7 of the Bristol traffic study, April 15th addendum, it says, and this is referring to the Putnam Road and Route 49 intersection, it says, the shoulder striking flares to widen the travel lanes to 22 feet on both approaches to Putnam Road, thus allowing vehicles to maneuver to the right and allow a through vehicle to continue straight without stopping. Route 49 has a speed limit, as you all know, 55 miles an hour. Well, I think the traffic study did not take into account that Route 49 is a designated bike route and eggs used daily by bicyclists and by joggers. So if a bicyclist or jogger is in that right-hand lane on the side, and if a trailer is, or a truck is turning in there, he's going to have to stop, and people going 55 miles behind him are going to have to come to a stop too. And I just think that issue should also be addressed, because it's a really good activity. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, can I just...
It is working. She just wasn't holding.
No, no, it's not that. I just want to ask about a question on that.
Yeah.
We got to see. Yeah.
So, I was thinking, and if I missed it in the traffic study, Route 20, we had some issues with the revamping of Route 20 that haven't come to fruition. If you've been following, is the step-in turning lanes. So, I didn't know if this comes forward, if there's any possibility. Working with Mass DOT so that there can be a widening and have those step-in lanes so that way through traffic can go through while people are waiting to turn. So I didn't know if that was a possibility or anybody thought of that.
Sure.
Do now at this time we'll take any Sturbridge resident that would like to make a This isn't working, see, no.
It's working. It's sort of working.
My name is Tom Geyer. I live on Podunk Road, and I just wanted to just go through a correction. When you were talking about having police and having it 10 days through the summer, it's planned from April to November. So April to November is 10 months, and you're assuming 4 weekends per month. So that's going to be 40 weekends. And assuming 2 days, that's going to be 80 days. And if it's 3 days, it could be 120 days. So I just want to put things in perspective that it could be 80 to 120 days where you might need police. That's all I wanted to say.
Do you have a comment?
Okay, the proponent has proposed that there's going to be 10 events a year here, and those would be on Sundays. And that's when the circuit of riders basically generally compete at each of these places. The one that we analyzed was a dual event. They had they had double the amount of riders because they had two different cycle events, motocross events, on the same day, intermingled. I mean, we have kids that are 6 years old, and we have guys that are 60 years old riding. So it's like, it's a big deal that they ride around, they get points for each win that they have, or coming in second or third, and that's what the type of event we're talking about, not just a normal Saturday or Sunday. I mean, those days, some people come to practice. But it's not like the event where they had 300 people come to the dual event at the site that I analyzed for. And that's where we assume that that's how many would be coming to our site. There are these 10 specific dates, not 180 days.
Do we have anybody else that would like to make a comment at this time? From Sturbridge or Charlton?
Is that it's important to note that the schedule is not firm, so how can the traffic study be accurate? Please take that into consideration.
Again, we look at the worst day, the worst event, and that's what we analyze for. And we see how bad it's going to be under that condition. If that repeats every week, it's the same analysis. The analysis is valid for the worst case scenario.
Alright, at this time, does anybody else on the board have any questions to ask? Alan?
Not working. I have a question to the applicant now on scheduling of this continued hearing, if I might, for a minute, Donald. What we've been doing basically is usually scheduling every other meeting for the next session. And obviously, what that would be for our next meeting would be the first Wednesday in June. Is the applicant's team prepared for that meeting or the following meeting in terms of giving us information for our peer review team on what will come up at those sessions on items in time for them to review? So we're substantively dealing with stuff the way we are tonight. Are you shooting for that day? Because the board has to vote tonight to continue to a particular day.
We feel that the second meeting in June would be probably safer.
So off the top of my head, and then if I can correct me if I'm wrong, just looking at the calendar, that would be the third Wednesday in June, which is Wednesday, June, thank you, Mr. Chairman, June 17th. That's what you're asking for?
Yes.
For continuance for that day. And then we'll inform you in the very near future the latest date that our peer review team needs information to properly review information, so by the time we get to that meeting, we have peer review analysis and recommendations to review that.
Okay. Certainly do whatever we can to get
you. I know that you've got Burton Engineering, I understand, working on from the first night in January, the civil engineering review. We're waiting for that to come in. You've got your noise engineer working on review for that. So that type of thing, the sooner the better, so our people can work on it and head to that third Wednesday in June for another substantive session.
So are we saying we don't know what the topic is on the third
through Wednesday?
Well, let me ask a question, and that's a very good question from this gentleman. The two topics that we need to head for next are both noise analysis and civil engineering. And I know that you had asked this evening to do traffic instead of civil engineering, because Burton Engineering is working on civil engineering changes that may relate to possible noise revisions. So,
thank you, Chief. So, are you looking that night to propose to the board we look at civil engineering, noise, or a combination of the two?
Combination
of the two, which makes sense because they interact and they connect, and then we can continue the review from there. So, that'll be June 17th. So, to clarify, we're looking at that, those combinations of elements for our next session of the hearing. Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to hold the board on continuing this public hearing until June 17th. At that time, we will be doing it in the library in Allen?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Okay. So I've spoken to the librarian and the room is available.
Do I have a motion to continue the public hearing until June 17th?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, everybody, for coming tonight. Your comments will be considered. At this time, being 8:30, we'd like to have a public hearing for Zero Point Development on Curtis Hill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Do I need to play? As you know, the Castigian commercial solar public hearing was opened at your last meeting, and the applicant Zero Point Engineering, Brendan Gove, asked for continuance this evening to May 20th. His engineer is still working on the revisions for Graves Lake to review. We'll get them, hopefully, according to the schedule that we suggested prior to May 20th.
I met with the engineer out there today and did test pits for the stormwater. He indicated to me that they hope to submit early next week. So that'll be good.
So I recommend a vote to continue to May
20th. Do I have a motion to continue the public hearing to May 20th?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I did email the board or we put it in your packet, but I'm pleased to tell you that the board's joint application with Housing Authority and with the working partnership of Bay Path Boquete to the state DHCD's PATH grant program was approved. We had asked, to refresh your memory, for a $30,000 grant with a $2,500 match from the Housing Authority and a $2,500 match from the Planning Board for a total of $35,000. They awarded us $20,000, and Phil DiMartino, the manager of the program, said it's because the money's limited and they're trying to spread it around as much. So he said what he'd recommend is Bill Scanlon, our consultant for planning, Mike Andrade, our consultant on the civil engineering, and myself, between now and the end of June, work with him on revising the application spreadsheet into the $25,000 total, and then if needed, we can reapply as an addendum when they get more funding if we still feel that it's crucial or needed for the extra $10,000. But I think we've got a core of $25,000 that will allow us to do the impacts. It was a verbal approval. He called to tell me the good news, and he said what they'll probably do is sometime between now and the end of June, they'll formally give it to us in writing and issue a press release for us to share also. And it's a fiscal year 2016 grant, so they'll forward to us a contract no later than the beginning of July that will kick off the project. You sign it and we'll all work together. I've informed John LaFlesh too, and he's excited that the partnership looks good to analyze that site across from Bay Path, engineering analysis for potential affordable housing and potential field usage for the schools, and I think it's a win-win, and I'm just excited.
Board members, have any questions on Alan's report?
Yeah.
the subdivision. And to refresh your memory, Mr. Blair had bought it from another developer, and then this is that little subdivision that was proposed as 9 lots, and a couple, put a copy down there and a copy at this end. He bought it from another developer and then came back a few years ago for revision. And what he was doing was working with the state's Office of Natural Heritage, Fisheries, Wildlife, because there is a rare, on part of the property, it's the habitat for a rare and endangered salamander. And so he understood that from the beginning when he bought it, that it would change his project. So if you recall, he came in to meet with you this past winter to give you an update. And at the time, you voted to endorse the agreement that Mass Fisheries and Wildlife had put together with him to create a habitat area, both a combination of the open space in the back of a few lots for permanent protection. And that was signed, and he provided us with a copy for that in our file. And he then said he'd be back, and that's one of your 3 items with him tonight on the subdivision, for an A&R to reduce the subdivision number of lots. Part of his agreement with the state on the endangered species is to reduce the number of lots from 9 to 7. Now, since he's not changing the right-of-way of the road or anything, he does not need a public hearing for subdivision revision. It's strictly lot lines, and under Massachusetts subdivision law, that's through an A&R, and that's what you have this evening. So what you have in front of you, and the purpose statement says on the right, the purpose of this plan is to revise previously approved lots 1 through 9 to lots 1 through 7. And the configuration meets all of our zoning on frontage and setback, and that reduces the impact to the endangered species protection area, and he's worked it out with the state, and the icing on the cake to get it final at the registry is the signing of the A&R plan. I'll point out one other item that he had changed the name of the road at his revision hearing with you guys a few years ago to Blackwell Drive, and that's what's on this plan at this time. There isn't. There used to be 9. And now we're down to 7. Yes. And then the open space that's permanent protection is down in this area. It's about 6 acres.
Where does this land go back to? Open protection? Conservation?
That will go to either Conservation Commission or the Charlton Heritage Trust, one or the other. And if they're not interested, our third party is the Greater Worcester Land Trust. The way we leave it is, under state subdivision law, it's the applicant's choice of which entity, and we recommend. So we've always recommended talk to Conservation first, go to the Heritage Trust second, and then the folks at the Greater Worcester Land Trust have said they'll always be the third one. So as you look around town in the various subdivisions, those are the 3 entities that control and manage the permanent protection in just about every subdivision.
Do they need a right-of-way to this?
The only right-of-way that's needed is a walkable one right here. That's what they went over with the Heritage Trust when they were first talking about it, yes. So this was what we originally approved in that respect.
Now the plots, was it 60,000 square feet, right?
If it was conventional, but because it's an open space one,
sorry,
it's a good question. Yeah. They can reduce it down to if they wanted to that, but you'd see a lot of them are still a lot more than that.
Yes, gotcha. Okay. Yes. That's what threw me off right there.
Good question. I think they're that larger because of the endangered protection.
So tonight he's asking for an extension.
No, he's asking you to sign this A&R that he will put on file at the registry that will reduce it from 9 to 7 in accordance with his agreement with the State Heritage Protection Program. So this will supersede the old 9 lot layout, and it's pretty routine.
Do you have any questions at this time?
And actually, Mr. Blair just walked in, so I've explained the A&R reduction from 9 to 7. The board's reviewing your A&R.
Oh, okay, thank you.
You know, we asked a question about accessibility. If you were to turn the open space, and Alan pointed out that there is a walkway.
I can't recall. I just mentioned the 3 entities we go to. Who are you talking to in the open space? Which of the 3?
It's Worcester.
Greater Worcester.
Oh, that's right.
That's what I was told. Yeah. Greater Worcester Land Trust.
That's it. Yeah. Greater Worcester Land Trust. That's who we made the deal with them. So.
Good. And you'll give us copies at the right point later in the project. At this stage, we don't need that, but you will.
Sure.
Yeah. Do you have any questions from the other end of the table?
No.
Okay. Being children, yep, absolutely. Got accessibility to there, and he wishes to change the name of the street.
Well, the name was changed a few years ago at a revision hearing.
Okay.
Adjustments in his subdivision design, and I asked you just to put it in writing. He's requesting to change the drainage pipe from reinforced concrete to high-density resin HDPE, and Mike can comment if he wishes. It's a request that Mike has no problem with. And the second one is a request to eliminate the islands in the cul-de-sacs of Avent Road and Blackwell Drive. And to give you the history on that, when the plan first came in, Jerry Foskett was not the highway superintendent. And the previous superintendent, whose name escapes me, was very big on island cul-de-sacs. There were a few abutters who did not want them, but the gentleman said, that's what I want in subdivisions. Since then, over the past several years with Jerry Foskett as highway superintendent, Jerry does not want cul-de-sacs. He feels it's a problem in the winter, both maintenance and the wear and tear and such. And in relation to that, Mr. Blair is asking if he could have a field reduction to take the cul-de-sacs out. Certainly have no problem in that. That's what the highway superintendent has been looking for in the last several ones. This predated, the approval of this predated that current policy of the past several years.
So you're asking to take the island out?
Yes, that is on the plan. It hasn't been built yet. You know, it's just.
And just have it all as pavement. And then the other question is concrete culvert pipe?
Yeah, on the islands too, the even roads and existing road, there's an existing cul-de-sac there. The previously approved plan showed them the requirement to construct an island in that road.
That's currently
just entirely paved, and they were to construct an island there.
Mm-hmm.
So they want to remove that one and the proposed
cul-de-sac. You want to go into this project?
Wow.
And the second item on the that's regarding the drain pipe material throughout the subdivision. HDP is a common drain pipe material now. It's used all over town in subdivisions and commercial sites.
Tree planting or anything on satellites or sidewalks?
Well, this one's already done.
No, that's all in the project already. That's all in the subdivision plan. He's not asking to remove any of that. All he's focusing on is requesting the pipe material switch and not having to construct those two islands.
I guess along with approving the A&R plan, I'm also going to be asking that the two things we just discussed, the culvert pipe and the island, be accepted with the A&R plan.
So moved.
Yeah. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
I can write it up as a decision from the board for you and for Graves Engineering.
Thank you.
Could you just remind the board, you talked about this in your other subdivision, about your plans this building season to begin road construction. Well, you did have your notice to proceed pre-construction meeting with Michael recently, and I issued the written notice to proceed. But can you just refresh the board of what your plans are for this season?
We're going to construct both cul-de-sacs, Dresser Hill, as well as Haggerty Landings. And actually, I've already taken, I think, three, maybe four deposits.
On this one or the other
Dresser
one?
Hill. Wow. I haven't even put the other one on the market yet.
Picking up.
The challenge, this district here, is very good school system. People really, really want to live here. It's a good
yeah.
thing.
Thank you. We'll sign the Mylar and date it. You can take a look. Just put one on and seal. When you're done with that one, I'll wait a few minutes.
Yep.
Have another hand.
Yeah.
Yes, we do also. That's a good point. Sorry, I'm kind of involved with stuff. Mr. Blair also submitted his annual approval extension request. I'll hand it to the chairman. The annual approval extension expires June 3rd, 2015, and he's looking for the annual extension to do June 3rd, 2016. June 3rd, 2016. Yeah, I'll let her sign and then we'll make up. This email as a form of request to extend an approval for the Dresser Hill subdivision from subdivision 2, June 3rd, 2016. Do I have a motion to accept it?
So moved.
All in favor? Our second A&R this evening is submitted by Rockaway Realty Trust on Baker Pond Road, and you're very welcome.
Thank you.
These were two separate lots that the applicant had originally come in with a common driveway special permit, which you approved several years ago, and he didn't develop it. And he decided recently that it just isn't worth it with the topography and the layout to do two separate lots, so he's recombining it back to one big lot, and he'll go for a building permit for one large house. So it's very simple. It's a recombination. The boundaries of it are combining the two, and it's back to what it was before he came in 4 or 5 years ago and divided it.
Now, does this, by signing this and approving it after 1 month, does it eliminate that special permit for the common?
The special permit expired.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, he let it go.
All right.
Yeah, but good. That's an important
wait,
question.
Let's just say in the instance that it was still valid, mm-hmm. and when someone comes to make it, lots back into one.
Yeah, then at the same time you'd be voting to rescind the approval because the new A&I would not make it. So this is the frontage on Baker Pond Road? Yes. And these were two separate lots. I didn't bring the old plan over because it's not, you know, we're not in the office, but there was a line that it split into two. He had a common driveway special permit and he decided this isn't the way to go after several years. I'm just going back to one big lot with a big house.
So I asked Ross to question the special permit has been.
Sorry. Yes. Sorry. Yep. So you don't need to vote on that.
Okay. Do I have a motion to accept Rockaway Trust proposal to take the two lots and make it into one?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
I
Chairman. I'd like to spend a few minutes with you and with Jane Garney, the board's administrative assistant, regarding information on the board's a particular warrant article. I believe it's warrant article 13, but it's the reclassification plan. It says classification plan. We refer to it as reclassification plan among the town employees because we have a classification plan. It's revising and updating it. As you know, about a year ago, the selectman and town administrator hired a consultant. We had a group meeting of the employees in the town hall, and the consultant informed us that the only focus of it was twofold. One, she would look at salary ranges compared to other communities for comparable positions, and if somebody was underpaid, and she jokingly said, when the day comes the town could afford it, they would be reclassified upward. And secondly, that they would look at job descriptions. They would interview each of us, which they did. I had a one-on-one interview with the consultant, I believe Jane did too. And that the consultant would make recommendations on potentially changing job descriptions. Now, that said, bear with me, please. I'll hand out to you right now my current job description prior to anything proposed for that town meeting, and I'll hand out Mrs. Garney's. And three in this direction. First, I handed out my position's official title is planning director, as you know. This definition, supervision, and job environment, duties and responsibilities. You flip to a second page, duties and responsibilities continue. Page three, qualifications. Page four, physical requirements. That's routine. I had a similar format and version when I was first hired 14 years ago, and off the top of my head, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, the board, through a previous board of selectmen, a previous town administrator, did a reclassification. We wrote this together as a more modern version for the year that we were doing it, leading to now. And I feel very comfortably, and I hope you will too, that this works today. It's still accurate, valid. That's my job description. Now I'll hand you Jane Garney's job description. As you know, in 2008, she was reclassified from department assistant, which was a lower level of clerical, to administrative assistant, clerical support. And I'm handing you a packet related to a few things on Jane's position. And when you get the packet, if you flip to the second page, you get Jane's current, adopted under town personnel and town regulations, job description. It's entitled Administrative Assistant Planning Board. Same thing as mine in terms of format. Definition, supervision, job environment, duties and responsibilities, minimum qualification. Now, if you bear with me, the warrant article that came on board related to reclassifying people is stated as follows, and I'll hand you three pages. Three in that direction, I mean one page, three in that direction. This is what department heads received via email, including myself, from Town Administrator Robin Craver a week or two ago. It says, Charlton proposed non-union classification, FY 2016 budget, recommendation of the Finance Committee, annual town meeting, May 18, 2015. And I won't go back into it right now in terms of this, but as we can see, there's issues about trying to split my position into two positions, and there are people who are trying to twist and interpret it politically that I hold two positions right now, and we all know I don't. There is an old history that goes back before me of a part-time EDC director. As planning director, you've assigned me to staff the Economic Development Commission the way I assist Housing Authority and others at times. There's here, leaving under N8, which is a level of salary classification, my job changing the title to planning director slash EDC, but at the same time proposing, it's very confusing, I don't have an answer for you this evening, I'm just pointing out to you, an N7 lower classification for planning director and an N5 even lower one for a new job called economic development coordinator to staff the economic, should be development planning commission, it says economic planning commission. Along with that chart, job description revisions have been prepared, and my understanding is that Rachel Hartwig, the personnel board member, and Robin Craver, the town administrator, were very hands-on in writing them with or without the consultant. I couldn't tell you the balance of the degree. But 2 days ago, on May 4th, we received the following email, and I'll make two hands out. One is an email memo from Robin Craver to department heads dated May 4th, and I'd like to hand it out and summarize it briefly. And then I'd like to hand out what came along. Attached are the department's job descriptions for yourself and employees under your supervision. Please review them. If you have reviewed them, let me know of any changes you wish to recommend by May 14th. If you need more time to meet with the board or commission, please let me know. A time will be scheduled for you to meet with Rachel Hartwood, Personnel Board Chair, or one of its other members. There are no changes in the script. If there are no changes in the descriptions, please let me know. Now I'd like to hand out those descriptions to you. Jane's description is attached to what I already gave you. If you flip through from the second, the third page, the fourth page, now you're on the fifth page, and we've highlighted a few things in yellow. This is the proposed revision to her position. And to summarize a few things and then move over to mine, and then I'd like to make some comments about it all. I would hope it's a typo. The title has been changed to department assistant for her job. That is not her job. That was the job she had up with the 2008. A lower level support staff position, a lower level salary range. It says department assistant. So I would assume it's a typo, and I'd recommend, when I get to a recommendation of a draft comment I'll give you that's addressed, a very confused statement that I don't understand under supervision received. The first sentence makes sense. Work is performed under the general direction of the town planner. And frankly, the reference should be planning director. I'm not being egotistical, but legally, my position is planning director. We should have accurate, and other town employees feel the same way on their positions. Then a sentence that I don't understand, work is performed independently requesting assistance with unusual situations which do not apply precedence. No idea what that meant. But to summarize hers briefly and to go to mine briefly, Jane and I have reviewed this, and we both have the same point of view. She had a different point of view, I respect it, and I presented, and she can too, that there's no need to change her position description in any manner. I just pointed out two items that are particularly deficient, but I don't see any point of having to change it at all in any manner. It doesn't make sense to me or to Mrs. Narney. Now, to go to mine, you have this memo already. You had a memo that we've reviewed in the past few weeks in which the selectmen and Robin Craver, over the objections of the planning board and the full EDC, are proposing to split my position into two, as you know, and roughly, real rough off the top of my head, about two-thirds of my salary and my time would be planning director for you. A third or so, roughly, would be wearing the hat of that new part-time position, and I'll go into the part-time position in a minute and my concerns and objections to it, but I want to hand you first a fresh copy of what you already have, but it's turned to the town planner's proposed position description. Jane highlighted in yellow the title, which again is incorrect. It says town planner, it should be planning director. And I'd like to make two or three comments on it. One, again, similar to Jane's position, in general, I don't see a point of changing anything. You had position description that very accurately describes my current job. A lot of this is very poor wording, and I don't mean to criticize anyone in a personal manner, but I'm being honest that very poorly written. I frankly think a lot of it is nonsensical or no reason to change things. If you flip to page two of it, I highlighted two things under job responsibilities. It talks about attending meetings and such, and it calls out particularly including attendance at department head meetings. And I thought that was a bit petty by the town administrator because, as you know, for quite a while she had deliberately scheduled department head meetings the one day and time I told her wasn't available, accused me of deliberately not attending those, and I made it very clear to her that that is not the case. It was a day and a time that I said I was not available, and she thus responded in the past year and changed. I've talked to a few other department heads and no one else has that in it. That should be in everybody's or nobody's. I just think it's related to that and I feel it's petty. Second, I highlighted the sentence, collaborates with building department, town council, planning board, and board of selectmen in order to interpret and amend the zoning ordinance in MGL. There's already a statement that doesn't talk about specific collaboration, just says provide staff assistance for zoning, bylaw, ordinance, etc. to pull those out, I think, is opening them into working with you when they don't. The Board of Selectmen don't have a role in this other than putting on a warrant something. And I don't see any reason to change that one either. So that's a comment there. If you flip the page, two pages over, you then come to the proposed economic development director position. Now, in that May 4th email, we did not receive that. I don't understand why, but since we have this from the previous memo, I included it to give you because it affects you and the EDC. The title is Economic Development Director. We understand it's part-time and looking to, I would wear that hat and a chunk of my salary under planning board would be diverted under that. And it has a position description. Under supervision received, it says works under the policy direction of the Board of Selectmen and Economic Development Commission and under the day-to-day administrative direction of the town administrator. So essentially, the town administrator becomes the chief staffer for economic development, and whoever holds this position is her staffer. And the Economic Development Commission in March met and discussed this, and unanimously, politely, professionally, eloquently, the six members there, in addition to the two members who couldn't make it, made their opinion that week that they are opposed to changing anything regarding the current staffing structure and opposed to anything like this, and yet this still moved forward after they made that clear. We, myself, the EDC chairman, Jay DiNarando, two EDC members, Rich Kerr and Peter Boria, and two planning board members, Ross Lemansky and Gene Vincent, and I went to a joint FinCom select board discussion last night on this, made our position clear, and to be polite, it was disappointing to say the least. I think we were very handcuffed in being able to discuss this every time we brought this up as part of the fact that they went to FinCom without our knowledge last Wednesday and had FinCom create the two separate line items in the draft budget. Talking beyond those two line items, they would not let us get into this beyond us bringing it up and saying that's not what we're here for tonight. So the bottom line is we come back to the reclassification warrant article at town meeting. And I know that a lot of other town employees are as in opposition as Mrs. Garney and I are to our particular ones. And regarding the comments in the May 4th letter by May 14th, if you bear with me for a minute with all of my stuff here, I drafted up a comment response that I'd like to present to the board and recommend it be finalized this evening. And I brought a lot of paper over from across the street, so bear with me. This is the last item I promise I'll hand out on this. And if I could briefly walk you through it, and then you, I respectfully defer to the board in finalizing. Three copies in this direction. I dated the draft May 7th, which is tomorrow, and it's addressed to both the personnel board and the town administrator, Robin Craver. And I mentioned in their draft, and you can read it completely on your own, that you reviewed it this evening. And I drafted up a couple of comments in opposition to opposing the town meeting reclassification plan warrant article. Number one, the board sees no need or valid rationale to change either one of the current planning director and administrative assistant position descriptions. The current language of both items is clear, accurate, and effective for the true purposes of both staff positions. The proposed revision descriptions for both positions are vague, poorly composed, inaccurate, and at times confusing as to the meaning of many statements and descriptions, as well as not reflecting the true work accuracy of both staff positions. Two, as we have stated repeatedly in recent weeks in numerous written correspondence and meetings, the planning board is firmly opposed to the proposed adoption of a separate economic development director position and position description. The staffing structure change as proposed by the town administrator and select board needlessly revises our current successful and effective planning staff structure for both planning board and EDC staffing. Third, finally, the board wishes to point out to you that both proposed position descriptions have incorrect titles. The town planner title is incorrect and the position is that of planning director. The department assistant title is incorrect and the position was reclassified in the year 2008 to that of administrative assistant. And I want to say something for the record too. It's important to repeat it as we've talked about before. In 2008, the position that Mrs. Garney holds was changed. Well, her first paycheck arrived for the new fiscal year back then and her pay increase wasn't there and she came to me. I went to Robin Craver and she said, well, the title was changed, the money wasn't. And I said, that makes no sense. I said, She was reclassified to administrative assistant like many others in the town hall, and every one of them received that. Since then, from time to time, you just haven't done it in the past year because you feel worn down politically by this. Since then, many times this board has written letters to the selectmen and spoken to selectmen and town administrator. Her union has brought it up because she's part of the clerical and administrative support union, and we get nowhere. Sometimes the answer is, well, it's a union issue. Bring it up in the next union negotiation. Other times they're saying, well, bring it up in your next budget proposal. We've put it in budget proposals. We've been ignored. I couldn't tell you sitting here, it's in the tens of thousands of dollars, how much money she has not legally received as she's required 2008, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 to be paid at that level. I would assume it's in the tens of thousands. It's illegal, it's immoral, it's unethical. You've done everything you can on that, and you've been ignored, and it's shameful for this town government, this select board, this town administrator, to hide by saying sometimes it's a union issue, at other times to say, well, it's a budget issue. We've been quiet for a year on it, but I'm putting it out there again and repeating it, and it's just one of those unfortunate things that is wrong, and in my opinion, illegal. And I'll just state it for the record one more time right now as we're discussing this. So that's my summary. Thank you, members of the board. If you'd like to review this, finalize it, do it, not do it, I put that out there for your consideration. Thank you.
I'm submitting this letter because this go to the personnel board and to
Yes, it's addressed to go to the personnel board and town administrator and CC to the select board and the economic development commission because they obviously have an interest and concern on the staffing proposal revisions also.
How do you have it CC to the economic commission and the board of selectmen?
Yes.
Is that something we send them a personal letter also, or is that just going to put in their mailbox?
What would happen is we'd give a copy, when we give a copy to the selectman's office for Mrs. Craver, we give a second copy for the select board, and her support staff then provides it to them. With the EDC, it would be handed to the EDC members at next Monday's meeting for their information, so they'd all receive it.
Okay. I just was concerned that.
No, it would be properly assured that each of the entities it's addressed to and CC would receive it.
This letter would also help with the Article 13 warrant for classification.
Yes, it would be basically expressing that you're opposed to that when it comes up for consideration at town meeting, that that's your opinion on that and the specifics of the descriptions in it, yes.
Because right now it's being sponsored by the personnel board and the board of selectmen.
Right. So that's why the letter is addressed to them, yes, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. At what time would, when the Article 13 is read, would there be a chance for the planning board members to oppose this as being sponsors, or does it get
The way it would work is, you're not sponsors of anything. You could speak if you wish at the town meeting when deliberation comes up on it. You can go to the microphone if you wish. You put in writing to let those entities know you're opposed to it in this, and it's the board's choice if you wish to go to the microphone and speak either as individuals or as a representative of the board.
So that would be our time to publicly oppose this Article 13.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Too bad by doing the poorly composed section. I'm just as much irritated about this whole thing as anyone is. I don't know if you want to
And I respect that. I gave you a draft to deliver. You understand I'm putting forward a consideration for a specific language.
Yeah, just as an angle to try and,
Whatever you'd like to change as a board, I
I'm just throwing that out there as a suggestion possibly.
Would you like to just have that eliminated completely?
Yeah. Just eliminated.
So you're looking at the fourth line down with the proposed revision. Be scratched out.
You want to take out just that word?
Yeah,
sentence?
Just take out poorly composed.
Okay.
The proposed revision is both vague, which it is, inaccurate, absolutely, and at times confusing.
Sure.
Without.
Okay. Thank you. I'd be glad to do that for you.
Yeah.
Would
it be useful to maybe have the personnel director come before the board to discuss this at all? Is that out of the realm, or is it a...
I couldn't hear you, I'm sorry.
Is it out of the realm to ask the personnel board director, though? Because, I mean, here we are, the board is essentially your boss. And here they are, they're changing things.
You could if you wish.
I'm just throwing that out there.
Sure. I'll give you my opinion. I think it's a waste of time from what I learned last night.
Okay.
When the six of us went to FinCom, no matter what you bring up on this topic, it's thank you for being there. I'm sorry. So you could if you want, but I think they'll just look at you and say, well, we don't agree with it. But if you want to do it, you could do it. It's up to you. I just don't think it'll...
We don't have a meeting between now.
Yeah. I guess I'm more procedural type thing. Why the procedure was... We were eliminated from
I don't get the same exact thing that we were.
I think you'll get double speak on it. I really don't.
Officials and you work for us. I just don't get how that.
Your job description was changed without consulting with us.
Correct.
Yeah. When we, and I want to elaborate on that, last year this came up and the town employees were very concerned about versions back then. Nothing like I've seen this, but some things. And so at the request of town hall employees, there was a meeting. And I do recall very clearly at that meeting that Select Board Chairman Rick Swenson said to all of us, we will have plenty of time prior to it heading for a town meeting for meetings, for comments, for input, and none of that happened. We just got this the other day.
To elaborate a little more on Ross's concern is, being a five-member board, nobody's been a personnel board. To consult with us as to how the job title should be changed, or he says how the job title being elected officials.
Yep.
Kind of.
Oh yeah.
Kind of throws a wrench at it.
Without a doubt.
And the sense also that Alan Kirkman works for
us,
the elected members of planning board, right? So we should have been.
Seems weird that the planning board director has to bring this to our attention, not the personnel board.
Right.
We get it secondhand.
Yep.
Just doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
And I do agree that this particular board is somewhat unique compared to other boards in the town, whereas Alan works for this board, and other department heads do not work for the board, but they've known this, it's been this way for as long as I've known, and they should realize that and have some consideration for us.
When the government was created, when the town government was created to be, you know, to be this way, they did it for a reason. And so it seems like that checks and balances, the reason why it's here is not being kind of, they're bypassing it. So I'm assuming that it's legal because this, but I question that in the back of my mind, but can they even change it legally if we're not on the board?
Well, the official change would only be by the town meeting, regardless of meetings and agreements or differences among individuals, boards, employees, departments, anybody. The bottom line is what happens at the town meeting, but I certainly share everything you've just said of concern about process, which is unfortunate. Yeah.
The process to get this to a town meeting doesn't make sense to me. The process to get this
right, all that's on the town meeting warrants in terms
right.
of review is that chart of categories.
Okay. The end numbers?
As far as I know.
Okay.
Maybe something to hand out, but that's all I know.
Right. I mean, this warrant number, or article number 13, does not, in my mind, relate to any particular rates, but it's not anywhere near the detail that the job descriptions are, and I'm sure that. Could there be other town employees that this has happened to also?
Everybody I've spoken to, and I can't say I've spoken to everyone, but more or less have the same opinion of this whole process and the quality of the information.
We shall try another letter.
Right. So we'll have Alan rewrite this letter tomorrow and send it out.
Yes,
thank you.
A couple of quick items, just heading for your next few meetings. You've got on your agenda for May 20th, 2 weeks from now, Elliot Burlingham's special permit for reduced frontage common driveway on two residential lots. And then on June 3rd, you've got two public hearings. One, the miniature golf course site plan application on Route 20, which they put up a sign, it's called Cutter's Miniature Golf. And also the Nexam Solar proposed site plan for property they're going to lease at the corner of Route 20 and Sampson Road, up toward where Sampson Road comes in on the west side of it. There may be a few other site plans coming in the next few meetings. Also, Water and Sewer Commission member Rob Lemansky, as you know, was briefly at your last meeting and reminded us of the annual touch base, which will be also at your June 3rd meeting, and we always invite the Economic Development Commission in for that. Secondly, at your next meeting, we also have on the agenda on May 20th, the final look-see at the Village District Study, and we'll invite the Economic Development Commission to that meeting too. I'll just quickly look at my list. I think that's it, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much.
All right, we just like to wrap this up with just doing the bills and payroll. All right, the bills this month. We have two from Graves Engineering. The total is $5,322.53 with the invoices enclosed. We have another one from Karen LaCroix, $57.39. We have one for Alan Gordon for postage for $63.79. We have one from Stonebridge Press for $73.50. Invoices enclosed. We have another one for Pitney and Bowes for $120, and we have one from APA for $95. Thomas Runland West for $123, and I got one here for reimbursement. And this is for the seminar you went to, right?
No, that's cell phone.
Okay.
The seminar was free, actually.
Okay. We have one for $78.70 with all the invoices totaling $416.70. Do I have a motion
pay these bills as read.
Second.
Then we have payroll. These payrolls would be for Alan and Jane. The time period is 5/11 to 5/16. We have from 5/18 to 5/23. We have from 5/25 to 5/30. And we have from 6/1 to 6/6. I have a motion to accept the four payroll vouchers as read. All in favor?
Aye.
With that, any other member have a comment at the time? With that, I'll make a motion to adjourn. Second?